Interfaces in Go provide a way to specify the behavior of an object. An example is the stringer interface defined in the FMT package in the standard library. We can define different types and implement a custom string method for those types. In this example, both person and underline structs define their string method. The body of the string method for each type is different. However, they both satisfy the stringer interface. This allows us to assign values of different types to a variable of stringer type, store different concrete types in the same slice, or pass different types to the same function if they all satisfy some interface. The interface types make Go support value boxing. We will learn what value boxing is and how it works in Go in more detail in this video. With value boxing, Go supports reflection and polymorphism. The Go language started supporting custom generics since version 1.18. The interface types are used to specify type constraints when using generics. With the introduction of generics, there are some changes to the concepts related to interface types. Before version 1.18, you could use all interface types as value types. After version 1.18, some interfaces can only be used as type constraints. An example of such a constraint-only interface is the ordered interface. Ordered is a constraint that permits any ordered type. Ordered types are any types that support less than or equal to, greater than, and greater than or equal to operators. For example, integer data types. Interface types that may be used as value types, like the stringer interface, are called basic interface types. In this video, we will be focusing only on the basic interface types. An interface type defines some requirements. All the non-interface types that satisfy these requirements form a type set of that interface. An interface type literal is written like this. The requirements are specified by embedding interface elements within the curly brackets. As of version 1.21, Go supports two types of interface elements, method elements and type elements. The method element is used to specify the signature of the methods that the object must implement to satisfy the interface. The type element was introduced as part of the generics implementation. The type element may be a type name, a type literal, a type union, or an approximation type. The read-writer interface contains three elements. The first one is a method specification for reading bytes. The second element is an interface type literal. This interface literal has one method element for the write method specification. The third one is a type name, which is the built-in error type. The error type is also an interface type. In our example, two interfaces are embedded within our read-writer interface, one using interface literal and the other using the built-in error type. Embedding interfaces is equivalent to recursively expanding elements of the embedded interface. The second example, that is the anyInt interface, embeds an approximation type. The type set of anyInt includes all types whose underlying type is int. The integer interface embeds a type union that includes five types. So the type set of this interface includes five types. The anyInt and integer interfaces are constraint-only interfaces that are used for defining generic types or functions. These examples were included in this video just to show the types of interface elements. We will only be discussing the basic interface type in this video. Two basic interface types are identical if their method sets are identical. If two types are identical, a value of one type can be assigned to a variable of the other type. Here we have two interface types with type names A and B with the same method specification. We then create two variables of type A and B. We are able to assign a value of B interface to the variable of type A interface because both A and B interface have the same method sets. Note that this works even if there are unexport methods in the method set of the interface, as long as they have the same method signature. However, unexport method names from different packages will be treated as different method names, even if the two method names are the same. The Go compiler generates a type description structure for each concrete type in our code. So the type description structure will be generated for built-in data types like integers, any function that you define, and new types that you define with type keyword. There are some fields that are common to all the data types. A struct with the name type is used to represent the fields that exist for all data types and is part of their type description structure. There could be additional data for representing a type. Those fields will be stored after the fields in the type structure. For example, the struct with the name struct type is used to represent the type description structure of a struct data type. The struct type contains two more fields for storing the package path and a list of struct fields. So a struct type is represented like this. The type struct that we saw is embedded within the struct type. This struct embedding is equivalent to defining the inner struct fields directly in the outer struct. These additional fields are accessed by reinterpreting the memory address for the type structure as this struct type structure. This is done using unsafe pointer operations. These details are not very important to understand the contents covered in this video. We only need to understand that a type description structure will be created for each concrete type, including interfaces. The methods defined on the types are also stored within the type description structures. Now let's see what the memory for an interface type will look like. Consider this code. We have a person struct with two fields, name and age. There are three methods defined on this person struct: one for generating a string representation, one for returning the name field, and another for returning the age field. We also have an interface type with the name user specifying two methods. Our person struct satisfies this interface. Within the main function, first, we create a value of the person struct. The memory representation for this struct type will look like this. We have already seen in a previous video about strings that a string is represented using two fields, a pointer to the underlying bytes and another field to store the length of this storage array. Next, we convert the person struct value to a user type, which is an interface. Now the variable u is a value of the user interface type, and it stores a value of our person struct. An interface is represented using two machine words in memory. A word is the amount of data the CPU can process at a time. The word size for a 64-bit CPU is 64 bits or 8 bytes. This is the same as the size of the pointer type. Two pointers are stored in the memory for the interface value. The first pointer points to the interface table, which contains information about the type stored in the interface, and the second pointer points to the associated data. Assigning a value of the person struct to a value of the user interface initializes both words of the interface value. The data pointer points to a copy of the value of the person struct stored in variable p. New memory is allocated to store a copy of the value of the person struct. A pointer to this newly allocated memory is stored in the data field of the iface struct. The interface table to which the first pointer points stores metadata about the type. The interface table is represented similar to this structure. Note that the second field in the struct stores the type description structure we mentioned earlier in this video for the concrete type stored in the interface. In our case, this concrete type is the person struct. As mentioned earlier, the type description structure for the person struct will be created at compile time. This type of information is used when using type assertions or type switch control blocks, which we will discuss later in this video. You might have noticed that the type struct definition we saw earlier didn't start with an underscore like written in this file. This is because of a type aliasing defined in the same package. The first field in the interface table structure is a pointer to the interface type struct, which is defined like this. This is the representation of the type description structure for the interface type, similar to what we saw for the struct type earlier. The type struct we saw earlier is embedded within the interface type. The interface type also includes a list of its method elements. This type description structure for interface type is also generated at compile time. The last field in the interface table is a list of function pointers. This will be used to store the pointers to the corresponding methods of the non-interface type. In the struct definition, it's defined as an array of size 1. In the source code, it is treated as a variable-sized array using unsafe pointer conversions and pointer arithmetics. Note that the interface type struct we see here is for representing the type information. The two-pointer structure we mentioned is for representing the runtime value of an interface. The type description structures for every type, including the interface type, are created at compile time. The type description structure contains the list of methods implemented by that type and some additional metadata. As you can see here, the type description structure for the interface type also contains its method list. The Go compiler builds a global table containing these type description structures. This global table is loaded into memory when the compiled binary is executed. The interface table is not generated at compile time. This is because the interface table contains information about both the interface type and the concrete type it stores. It isn't reasonable to precompute all possible interface tables for all the concrete types and interface pairs since most of them won't be used in the program. So the interface table is computed at runtime when a value of a non-interface type is converted to an interface type. The method table of the interface table is populated with function pointers by looking at the method table of the concrete type. Note that the method table inside the interface table only stores the methods that the interface specifies. However, the method table of the concrete type will contain all of its methods. In our example, the method table for the concrete type person contains 3 methods, while the method table for the interface type user only contains 2 methods. Each interface table is only computed once and cached in the global map for runtime performance. If the interface involved is an empty interface, it has no methods. So there is no need for an interface table. Instead of storing a pointer to the interface table, the runtime representation of the interface stores a pointer to the type descriptor of the concrete type that exists in the global map I mentioned earlier. Go defines a separate struct with the name eface for representing the empty interface. You can use either type assertion or type switch blocks to inspect the dynamic type and value stored in the interface value. The type assertions has 2 forms. Here, the variable I will be an interface value. The variable T can be an interface or a concrete value. The single value form will panic if the dynamic type stored in the interface value is not the type you specify. Note that a type assertion on a nil interface will always fail. The type switch control block is an enhanced version of the type assertion. It looks like this. The type and value of the variable V we create in the switch statement will be different within each branch. For example, inside the branch for string, V will be of type string. The second branch will match if the dynamic type is either an integer or unsigned integer. Since we specify 2 types here, the type of V will be the empty interface. So far we have learned that interfaces store both type information and data. An interface is nil if both the type and value fields are nil. In this example, we implement the error interface on the MIRA struct. Within the main function, we create a value of type pointer to MIRA and store nil in it. Then we assign this value to an error interface value. Even though the value assigned is nil, our error interface value is not nil now. The reason is that the type information field, that is, the interface table of the interface, is not nil even though the data field will be nil. To clear the value stored in an interface, you can assign an untyped nil value to it. That clears both type and data pointer fields of the interface. This is explained in detail in the FAQ section. We saw that when calling a method through an interface, Go has to do some additional work like looking in the interface table to identify the actual method implementation that needs to be executed. To see how much is the overhead when calling a method through an interface, we can write a simple benchmark like this. Here we define a doer interface which specifies a single method that returns an unsigned integer. Within the benchmark function, we create a value of the empty struct type we defined. We also create a value of our doer interface and assign the value of our empty struct to it. Then we have 2 sub-benchmarks defined which call the do method. In the first sub-benchmark, the method is called directly on the concrete type. In the second sub-benchmark, the method is called on the interface value. From the results of the benchmarks, we can see that direct method call takes 0.28 nanoseconds whereas calling the method on interface value takes 1.8 nanoseconds. As you can see here, there is a slight overhead. Here, the compiler is able to inline the method call since the body of the do method is small. Inlining is an optimization where the compiler places the body of the function directly where it is used and thus avoids function calls. We can ask the compiler not to do the inlining by adding a compiler directive like this. Now if we run the benchmark, we see that direct method call takes 0.84 nanoseconds and method call through interface takes 1.92 nanoseconds. In the next example, we take the concrete value stored inside the interface using type assertion. Now if we compare the time taken for method calls, we see the values are almost equal. Note that such type assertions will cause runtime panic if the value stored inside the interface is not of that concrete type. In the next example, our type implements the reader interface defined in the IO package. Within the benchmark function, we define an array of 100 bytes and pass it as a slice to the read method. Creating an array or slice and passing it to methods is a common pattern in Go to reduce allocations. We expect this array to be allocated on the stack in both cases. This happens to be the case when the read method is called directly on the concrete value. But when the read method is called through the interface value, the array is allocated on the heap. Also, the time taken for the method call has increased to 19.5 nanoseconds with one allocation. The reason for this allocation is that within the body of the method, we could do something like storing the value in a global variable. Then the value must be valid for the entire life of the program. If Go allocates the value on the stack, the value becomes invalid after the function returns. When the method is called directly on the concrete value, Go's escape analysis is able to prove that we don't hold on to the past value after the method returns. However, with interfaces, the compiler does not know the implementation of the method at compile time, and that causes the method parameter to be allocated on the heap. We already learned in a previous video about methods that when a method is called, Go automatically passes the receiver parameter as the first argument. So in many cases, the values you assign to the interface will get allocated on the heap. For example, here we define the myInt type which satisfies the stringer interface. We have a function that accepts a stringer and calls the string method on that interface. In the main function, we create a value of myInt type and assign it to a value of stringer type. As you can see here, even though m is an integer that could be stored on the stack, it gets allocated on the heap because of the interface conversion. In some cases, even though the method is called through an interface value, the compiler will have enough information to know which concrete type is stored in the interface. In this example, the only change is that the values are defined inside the sub-benchmarks. Here, even though we call the read method through a value of the reader interface, Go knows that the concrete value stored inside the reader interface is the value of the empty struct we defined. Since Go knows which method will be called, Go can perform all optimizations like in a direct method call. This is called devirtualization. As you can see in the benchmark results, the array gets allocated on the stack itself, and the time taken for the method call is reduced.